Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome back to the Symposium series on global food policy and food security. I'm Roz Naylor. I run the Center for Food Security and the Environment here at Stanford, and we are very happy to be putting on this series with the support of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. I recognize a number of you in the audience, and I'm glad you come back every session. As you know, you're part of an audience that spans not just Stanford, but throughout the universities in the United States and overseas. This is our first remote teaching experience that we've really put together here, and we're really happy to be able to have the lectures videotaped throughout the world. So we're very excited to have a fantastic lineup of speakers today. Actually, the land issue is one of the more challenging issues for those of you who worked in development. And especially today, with all the discussion of land grabs and land acquisitions, I think it's a very pertinent topic. And we have two very strong experts in this area. Thom, Jayne, who many of you have met from other parts of this symposium series, is a long-term distinguished scholar in Africa and somebody who we have had nice collaborations with. He did his BA at Bucknell University and his PhD at Michigan State University, where he spent most of his career, in fact, all of his career so far. He's a real African specialist. And when I look to somebody for expertise on smallholder agriculture or any of the dynamics in African agriculture, I always look to Thom's papers or just call him directly and ask him a question because he seems to know everything that's going on in Africa. He has had multiple posts. Currently, he's in Zambia, living for several years, running a policy program down there on smallholder agriculture. He's also been posted in Zimbabwe and Ethiopia and has done surveys in many other countries as well. What he brings to the table is real field experience and data from the field. He also brings real policy advising expertise. And those of you who know Michigan State will know that Michigan State trains a number of African specialists, is in the field in both East, Southern, and West Africa, and really plays a leading role in policy advising. And so Thom is currently tackling some of the toughest issues in Africa, dealing with productivity, constraints, fertilizer, water, and land. Some of his PhD students have we're trying to recruit. They're all excellent and really reflect his own expertise. He's also won a number of awards for articles. I'll just mention a few in the International Journal of Ag Econ on African fertilizer subsidies and also the Schultz Award for fertilizer subsidies in Malawi. He's a prolific writer and a very clear writer. So we welcome Thom. His current research is on the principal challenges facing smallholders in Africa, and he'll be talking and leading the discussion on land resources today. As the commentator, we're very, very pleased and lucky to have Derek Byerlee with us. Derek is among a very long list of very distinguished agricultural economists from down under, from Australia. The list goes on, but Derek is among the top of that list, and so we're really pleased to have him. Did his BS in agronomy from the University of Adelaide, his PhD in ag econ from Oregon State University. And he also has extensive field experience broadly throughout the globe in Asia, has lived and worked in Pakistan, Papua New Guinea, for example, and in Africa, areas such as Sierra Leone and Ethiopia. But he's had a number of international positions, the most prominent of which have been on the economics research team at CIMMYT, the International Center for Maize and Wheat Improvement. In fact, his nickname used to be Mr. Wheat. I don't know if it's still Mr. Wheat, but you can call him that, I guess, if you want to. Then he was the lead economist at the World Bank. So he's really a very distinguished economist. In our field, one of the prime sources that we use now is the World Development Report that was on agricultural development in 2008, and Derek was the lead author of that. I'm hoping that you will write another one in your consultancy position now. We're very lucky to have Derek with us. He's done a lot of work on the land issue, really knows it very well, and is working particularly on post-green revolution technologies. I think one of the questions that's out there as we try to feed the world is, can we do it through intensification, some of the Green Revolution approaches, or through extensification through land expansion. And these will be among the topics that we're going to talk about today. So we really are pleased to have two of the best in the field for this, and we look forward to your comments. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much, Roz, for that. It's a pleasure to be here. This paper is a first for me in two respects. In the first one, there's going to be quite a bit of information that I haven't presented before. But the other first for me is that for the first time in my professional career, my parents are in the audience. And I'm kind of concerned with what Derek is going to have to say about this, but I'm really concerned about what my mom is going to say. Anyway, it's a pleasure. Thank you again. Okay, so the title of this talk has to do with land issues in Africa. I'd like to acknowledge my two co-authors, Milu Moyanga, who is from Kenya. He's a PhD student also at Michigan State, and Jordan Chamberlain, also a PhD student of mine at Michigan State. Be seeing both of them tomorrow when I go back into the icebox. Okay, so to start out with, in his 2010 presidential address to the Agriculture and Applied Economics Association, Thom Hertl raised the specter of this Malthusian land pressure issue hitting the global land base. I'm sure that many of you have read stories in the New York Times and all sorts of newspapers about this. It's a very topical issue. What's potentially driving this perfect storm? Well, there are at least three factors. One is there's increasing use of farmland in the world for fuel, through biofuels. Second one is that there's rising incomes in middle-income countries, the so-called BRIC, the countries, the Brazil, Russia, India, China. Many middle-income countries, rising incomes, increased demand for food, pushing up food prices, pushing up the demand for global farmland. And then the third one, we believe that climate is changing in some ways. It's going to be very difficult to predict how. But all of these things put together may put increased pressure on world's farmland. So the ironic thing is that Africa, which is the most food insecure and impoverished continent in the world, also has the greatest supply of unutilized arable land in the world. So, when we put these things together, the question that I'd like to ask today and try to talk a little bit more is, what's the impact of all of this on the livelihoods of the millions and millions of people who live in rural areas in Africa? What is the development pathway in light of the fact that the demand for land is going to be probably rising on the continent as well as the globe? So those are the issues I'm going to deal with. How am I going to deal with them? Well, for the past 15 years or so, I've been involved with a handful of African governments in helping them implement nationally representative farm surveys. So as an example, we're doing one in Zambia this year, about 14,000 rural households, so it's supposed to be nationally representative. The government of Zambia is most interested in predicting what national food production is going to be for the coming years, so they'll know how much they can export, or if need be, how much to import, and these kind of annual decisions, much like the way the USDA does here in the United States. But in addition to collecting information on production, we also collect information on the farm sizes of, you know, for these 14,000 households. What are they growing? How much are they selling? What's their income? How much income are they getting from off-farm activities? And sort of a whole handful of information that helps us monitor and assess how these rural agricultural systems are evolving over time. So that's one source of data. And the other source of data is gridded sort of Landsat photography, looking down and looking at 1 square kilometer grid cells of the entire continent. This kind of information has become available in recent years, and it shows how land use patterns are going, how much land is arable, who's living on that land, how many people, and so forth. So it gives us a much more disaggregated picture of population density in rural areas and how and what part of land is arable. When you fly over many of these parts of Africa, as I'm sure many of you in the audience have, you look down and it just looks like there's tracts and tracts and tracts of unutilized land. But ironically, when you look into it, here's a picture of Kenya. There are many parts of rural Kenya that are densely populated. At the same time that there are many parts of Kenya that aren't inhabited at all. I think, let me see if there, here we go. Okay, so this is basically pastoral, desert land, pastoral. Much of the crop production in Kenya occurs out here, but these blue spikes show you that they're quite densely populated. Here's a contrasting case of Zambia, the country I live in. These big spikes are, these big spikes here are the urban areas. So this is Lusaka and so forth. So there are many areas out here that are quite sparsely populated. I'll try to get to that in just a second. So let's talk the main issues that I'm going to cover. Number one, let's look at what is the extent of and magnitude of land pressures facing Africa right now. That's number one. Number two, what are the impacts of growing land constraints on the behavior and the welfare of smallholder farmers in Africa? The third one is, I'd like to make the case as to why there's generally no alternative to a small farm-led development strategy in Africa if poverty reduction is going to be part of the goal. That's number three. And then the fourth one, we get to the normative parts of this. What are the strategies, the potential strategies to deal with poverty and hunger in Africa in the context of increased demand for global farmland? Okay, so these are the four issues. I'll take them one at a time. I think I'll give you a heads up as to what the broad conclusions are, so you can keep those kind of in mind as I walk through the rest of this. The first one is that there's major political economy problems that need to be dealt with. There are cases, which I'll go over just now, where agricultural growth has been quite impressive, and yet it's had virtually no impact on poverty reduction. And land has a big role to play in the fact that that happens. So that's the first conclusion. The second one is that, unfortunately, most national development strategies for Africa pay very little attention to land issues and land constraints. So we feel that you know, a viable poverty reduction plan for many parts, not all, many parts of rural Africa, need to start taking more explicit account of land pressures in African agriculture. And then there's the issue of foreign investment. This is one that probably has had the headlines in most cases. And here, we feel that there may be some scope, and Derek will talk much more about this than I will. There's some scope for foreign investment in agriculture, but we wouldn't want that to divert attention away from what remains the central problem facing rural areas in Africa, and that is how to reduce hunger and poverty through a broad-based, inclusive growth strategy. So those are the major conclusions. So now I'll go one by one through these points. All right, what's the evidence of land pressure in African agriculture? Here is the second most populated country in Africa, Ethiopia. And what's on the x-axis here is population density. This is a histogram. The y-axis is the fraction of these 1 square kilometer grid cells. So there must be about 40 or 50,000 of them for Ethiopia. So if you look at them all together, it looks like the vast majority of these 1 square kilometer grid cells are very sparsely populated. The majority of them very sparsely populated. Just to give you a reference point, the FAO has estimated that roughly 500 persons per square kilometer is the maximum carrying capacity for rain-fed agriculture with one season that's not irrigated. So that's a rough computation. But as you can see, almost all of Ethiopia's rural lands are below 500 persons per square kilometer. Note, however, that this is all rural grid cells. Now, what happens if I change this histogram from all rural grid cells to only the arable ones? Only the arable grid cells, and I change the unit of observation from being this 1 square kilometer grid cell to people. So I'll rescale this now. where the histogram is in people and not grid cells. You get a very different picture when you do this. So here's the 500 persons per square kilometer threshold, and you can see that over half of Ethiopia's rural population per arable hectare live in areas that exceed the FAO's maximum carrying capacity. I want to say again that that 500 person per square kilometer threshold should be taken as our order of magnitude estimate. But you can see that the picture looks extremely different when it's people that you're plotting instead of land. Nigeria, the most populous country in Africa. Here's the first one where we're counting all rural grid cells. And now we're changing it to where we're looking at just arable grid cells, and the fraction is the proportion of people living in rural areas. So that's the number one and number two most populous countries in Africa, accounting for about almost 40% of the continent of sub-Saharan Africa's population. Let's talk about the more extreme cases. Rwanda, where there was a civil war and 6 million, I think 1 million people died of genocide. Even now, the situation looks extremely packed in rural areas. And there are some accounts that had said that land constraints were a primary factor driving the civil instability in Rwanda. Here's Kenya. Kenya is also a fairly densely populated place in the areas where the rural people are located in any event. So I put these up here just to show you that despite the perception, there's a widespread perception that Africa is a land-abundant place, and it is. Most of the area is sparsely populated. When you turn it around and look at where the people are, the picture changes dramatically, and we have a situation where land constraints are there. Here's one case in the opposite direction. Zambia, it's very sparsely populated, even when you look at arable land and people. So there are exceptions, and Zambia is an important one. So the takeaway message here is that much of rural sub-Saharan Africa's area is sparsely populated, but a high proportion of the rural people in the continent do live in densely populated areas. So that's the first thing. Let's look at trends in land-to-person ratios over time. And here, from the 1960s, let's take Ethiopia, the land-to-person in agriculture ratio was about a half a hectare, 0.5. But over the course of 40 or 50 years, that shrunk by more than half. Kenya, 0.64 persons per, 0.64 hectares per person in agriculture, which also is now under 0.3. So there's some dramatic declines over time. What's driving that? Well, population growth, number one. Number two, hitting the land frontier, where there are constraints to expansion that are a combination of historical factors, regulatory problems, market failures. I'll get into that later. So you can see that for quite a bit of the continent, land-to-person ratios are shrinking. There are some other parts in the continent where it's not shrinking very much. Nigeria is one of them. So there is variability here. I don't want to paint with overly broad brush, so I want to make that point clear. Here's work that comes from the farm surveys that I told you about earlier. And what we did was we took all of the 5,000 farms, ranked them from the smallest farm up to the biggest one, and then we divided them into five equal quintiles. And you can see that among the smallest group, the smallest 20% of farms in all of these countries that we've looked at, smallest 20% are virtually landless. Even the second 20% have less than 1 hectare of land and under primarily rain-fed conditions. It's not until you get into the top 20% here that you see farm sizes that are over 2 or 3 hectares in size. So a very, very constrained picture here on the bottom end in every single country that we've looked at. And just to show you what the impacts of that are on poverty, I'm going to walk you through this graph. This comes from 2008 in Zambia, but for every single country that we've done this for, it shows a very, very consistent picture. So allow me to walk you through this. What we did was took all of the households who accounted for half of the maize sold nationally. So when we found out who's accounting for half of all the maize sales in the country from the smallholder sector, we ranked them into one group. And believe it or not, that accounts for 2% of the rural population. 2% account for half of all of the maize sold in Zambia from that smallholder sector. Now, the rest of the 50% of maize sales is accounted for by about 30% of the farmers. And that means that about two-thirds, 67%, of the farmers in Zambia, almost a million households, do not sell maize at all. So now let's look into this a little bit. What's their farm size? Well, on average, 7.2 hectares per farm, 1.9 hectares, 1.1 hectares. These are the ones who are showing up down at the bottom end of the land distribution in the prior graph that I put together. Let's look at their asset values. And the assets that we're counting are livestock, plows, harrows, scotch carts, irrigation equipment, and so forth. The top 2% of the farming population, these are African farmers. They're not counting commercial, white commercial settler farmers. About $4,000 worth of assets. The rest of the maize sellers, 250. The really poor households, 129. So that's their assets. Now let's look at their gross maize sales. Here's $3,000 per household in 2008, $172 per household, and then by definition, zero, because this large group down here at the bottom isn't selling any maize. Now, you may ask, well, maybe these households down here at the bottom, maybe they're not selling maize, maybe they're selling other things. There's cotton, there's groundnuts, there's cassava. So the next column, gross revenue of all crop sales, we've now tallied that up. 3,300, 252, 57. So they're not selling much of anything. Now let's look at perhaps they're getting most, these ones are getting most of their income from off-farm. That's a possibility too. So now this last column is going to look at total household income. That's crop, livestock, and non-farm income. Total it all together. Comes up with $7,000 per household among the top 2%. $1,200 among the rest of those maize sellers, and $700 per year among the two-thirds of the people who are in the bottom of the land group. So that $756, by the way, is well below the poverty line for most of them. So this is where rural poverty is concentrated. In Zambia, it's 78% right now. This is where it's concentrated. And when you look at rural population growth rates, they're quite low. Most of Africa's rural populations are growing at 1.5. This is FAO statistics. World Bank's rural population growth rates are a little bit higher, but still usually below 2%. Why is that happening? Well, much of the migration off farm into urban areas is being driven by this situation. And this has been documented because in the surveys, we ask them, we're charting, monitoring these households over time. When households leave the area, we ask, Mr. Saludo go? So we're able to track where they went. And as I'll show you, I think, in a slide coming up, in the most densely populated areas, that's where the outflow of labor is the greatest. Into rural, into urban areas. So some of the problems of urban slums and sanitation and housing problems and congestion and health problems in urban areas are linked in some respect to the problem of inability to earn a livelihood among this bottom tier here. So it's kind of linking together some of the rural problems of land access to some of the urbanization problems. Okay. So I've tried to deal in point one there with just evidence of land constraints. For some groups, it actually is a jarring contrast with their impressions because the continent is mostly sparsely populated. And so it's hard to sort of think about where the people are in some ways. So that's why I wanted to walk you through point one. Now let's look at impacts of rising population density. Here's the relationship in these five countries between household farm size, which is along the horizontal axis, and the log of income, of per capita income along the vertical axis. And you can see that in every one of these cases, there's a pretty steep relationship. As you increase landholding size, income rises dramatically, especially in a place like Rwanda, very land-constrained areas. And then after a while, it tapers off in all of these countries too. So the real benefit to promoting land access among the poor will occur at moving from a farm size of 0.25 hectares per capita to 0.5. That's where some, or beyond. So that relationship seems to be very strong in all of these countries. I wish I had time to show you how we generated these results. These come from econometric models of Kenya. I'm not going to go through the methodology, but I think the impacts are interesting to show here today. Let's take this one. This should be pretty, self-intuitive. As population density rises, we find that holding everything else constant that we can control for in the survey data, that average farm size declines dramatically. It's what you'd expect. So the more densely populated areas, land's getting squeezed, so farm size goes down. So does the area under cultivation as well. And so does fallows. I didn't put that up there, but fallows also get reduced with population density, which leads to land degradation as population density rises. This one shows the intensity of input use. So this is fertilizer, hybrid seed, insect pesticides, and so forth. And you can see that as population density rises, and consistent with Esther Bosserup and others, you see that there's increasing intensification up to a point. Beyond a certain point, which is around 500 or 600 persons per square kilometer, according to our estimates, you start to see a tailing off of input intensification. And I'll talk a little bit more later about why that might be happening. Here is intensity of fertilizer use. Again, it starts to decline beyond a certain point. Net farm income per hectare, also same thing. We're seeing that this kind of threshold, this data comes from Kenya, if I didn't mention this, starting to decline. Net farm income per adult equivalent and so forth. You can see that there appear to be some problems occurring in rural areas when they get to be too densely populated. Now, how are these farming systems changing? I told you a minute ago that we're finding net outflow of labor to be especially high. I think it's 4 times higher in the densely populated areas than in sparsely populated areas, moving into the towns. Farm size is shrinking over time. Pass over this. Fallow area is declining. Farmers in high density areas are devoting a greater share of their land to high value crops. We're seeing that. That's probably a good thing, especially in areas where the markets or food markets function well. This provides some ability for farmers to diversify into horticulture, dairy, other things, and they get the income from those crops to buy back the maize that they otherwise would have tried to produce if the markets were less reliable. So number 4 is kind of an important thing that's helping to deal with rising population density. Last point is that while we would like to see many of these rural households increasingly diversifying into off-farm employment, there are constraints on that. And we find that even among the land-poor households, the ones at the bottom of the land-holding size spectrum, most of their income still comes from agriculture, not off the farm. So it's a very big challenge. And I hope that, up to this point, you're convinced that dealing with poverty in these countries is going to require dealing with the bottom end of that spectrum, unless there's some other engine of growth that can come along and pull them out of it, pull them out of rural areas into other things. We've been racking our brains for about 30 years trying to understand what that might be and how that will occur. Okay, so the takeaway messages on this point are that many areas seem to have reached a population density threshold, and this is giving rise to significantly lower farm incomes and asset wealth. In Kenya, about 14% of the rural population live in areas exceeding that threshold, and that that proportion is rising every day as population growth rises. Reasons. Why would this threshold effect be, why would we be seeing this? Well, as farm size shrinks, it's increasingly difficult to produce a surplus, holding other things constant. As it's difficult to produce a surplus, then capital constraints become more binding. It becomes difficult to finance your investments in fertilizer and other technologies that could help you intensify. So that has an impact on productivity. We're also finding that as population density rises, the fallows that are generally used in African farming systems to restore soil fertility are compromised. So that's another factor. And that off-farming opportunities are really linked to education. And most of the rural poor have not only small farm sizes, but they also have low levels of education. So dealing with education, which is a long-run issue, is nevertheless going to be a very, very important one for dealing with the challenge here. Okay, the third issue now that I wanted to tackle was why is it that there's no alternative to a smallholder-led strategy? I would say that maybe five years ago, there wouldn't have been any controversy about this statement. But increasingly, in the last 5 years or so, I think that there is. I'll just leave it at that. But many of the pioneering development economists, even the ones from Stanford here, I'm thinking of Bruce Johnston in particular, his pioneering work of documenting what led to the Green Revolution in Asia and South Asia and so forth. How did India go from a very poor place to where it is now? Well, that was through processes of agricultural growth, and I would say broad-based, I'd emphasize broad-based agricultural growth. In a place where 50 to 70% of the rural population are engaged in agriculture, there aren't very many levers to really reduce poverty and get growth processes going except by focusing on the activities that 50 to 70% are primarily engaged in. And that in most of Africa still is agriculture. Agricultural growth with poverty reduction, the evidence to date in most places in the world has shown that it has to be smallholder led. There are places in the world, like Latin America, where agricultural growth has been achieved without having much impact on poverty reduction. And the latifundia system in much of Latin America is an example of that. It's important to talk about these multiplier effects. What are multiplier effects? Well, if the growth in agriculture is broad-based, if you can put an extra $100 or $200 in the hands of small farmers and millions of them, then what do they spend their money on? First of all, they tend to recycle almost everything that they earn because they're poor, so they spend most of the extra money they get. They tend to spend it on things like roofing sheets, bricks, corrugated iron, veterinary services, blacksmithing, inputs like fertilizer and so forth. And it's this kind of expenditure pattern that allows there to be a demand for non-farm activities, all of these kind of off-farm activities. So the demand for urban employment, the demand for urban sector, manufacturing and so forth, where is that going to come from in a place where you have 70% of the people based in agriculture? It's going to come from agricultural growth, just like it did in most of Asia. So I don't want to spend too much time on this, but I think that here in 2011, it's important to kind of review what Bruce Johnston and John Meller and Michael Lipton found based on Asia, which was that the growth processes there had to be broad-based, and that's why agriculture was smallholder-led agriculture was so important to getting them out of that factor, out of that problem. Now, 2011 might not be the same as 1960, 1970, and I think the burden of proof will be on those who say that it's possible to think of other ways, to not the way Asia did it, but maybe there's some other ways out there that can really drive growth and pull rural households, poor rural households off the farm. I don't think that that sector and that magic bullet has been identified yet. Okay. So I want to give you an illustration based on work that we just did in Zambia. Zambia, I think, is a really interesting case of how agricultural growth hasn't had a dent on poverty. Over the last 5 years, Zambia has initiated a major input subsidy program. Input subsidy program, they're allowing or they're giving access to smallholder farmers to use fertilizer at about 20% of its landed price. And they're also subsidizing the price of the output. So there's a marketing board in Zambia that's buying maize at $300 a ton, quite high. Okay, so that's the major engine that the Zambian government, the past Zambian government, has utilized in order to stimulate growth and poverty reduction. They were successful in some ways. They were successful because in a very short amount of time, national maize production doubled. But as I've given away already, rural poverty has remained at 78% the whole way. Now, how can this happen? How can you have a doubling of the staple crop, the one that you know is covers about 50% of all the land area in Zambia? How can you have that kind of growth? It was yield growth too, and not have any impact on poverty reduction. So to show you how this is done, I'm going to walk you through. It's going to take about 5 minutes to do, but bear with me while I put you through these numbers because I think it's a highly informative conclusion that comes out of this. What we did was disaggregated the 14,000 households by farm size. So it turns out that 41% of the farms in this survey were less than 1 hectare. 33% were in this 1 to 2 hectare range, and so forth. There's 2 to 4 hectares, 5 to 9. By the time you get over 5 hectares, you have 2.9% of the farm population in that category. And then half of 1% are from 5 to 20 hectares. So that gives you an idea of farm structure to begin with. Okay, now, here are the annual mean maize production levels. I won't walk you all through this. The nationally, Zambia produced about 1.3 million tons of maize a year on average over this period. In 2011, maize production had doubled. In fact, it's doubled for the past 2 or 3 years. So this, since about 2009. And so it's now doubled to 2.7 million tons. That's a pretty dramatic apparent success story. In this column, we've just subtracted this number from that one to show who's accounting for this increase in maize production. So for example, during 2011, the small farms here harvested 309,000 tons of maize. In the baseline period, it was 212. So this minus this. So this small farm group has accounted for 96,000 additional tons of maize production nationally out of the 1.4 additional tons, which is 2.7 minus 1.3. So if I took these numbers here and I divided them by the number of farms that are in each size, what I would have is the average increase in maize production per farm. And when you do that, you find that among the very small farms, they had an average of 150 kilograms more maize production each year. In this group, it was 600 kilograms more. But once you get into this farm size, you see where the real action is. That it's down here in the 10 to 20 hectare group and the 5 to 9 hectare group. They're the ones that really accounted for the increase in maize production. Why did that happen? Let's go through this again and let's see where the fertilizer. I told you that it was a fertilizer subsidy program that had a lot to do with this increase in maize production. 28% of the households nationwide received this subsidy to fertilizer. But among the smallest farms, only 14% got them. By the time you get up to the bigger farm groups, over half did. And when you look at the amounts that they received, 24 kilograms, all the way up to, 12 times more, 345 among this group. So this was a poverty reduction program that was targeted to large farms. Unfortunately, you can imagine that the percentage of farms selling and the maize sales that were derived from that. Here we have 135 kilograms on average of maize being sold, all the way up to 15 tons among this group. So you can see, and then the marketing board that was offering $300 a ton for maize, who's going to drive the benefits of that? Well, obviously, you can't derive benefits from maize sales unless you're selling maize. So it's accruing to this group. And this group tends to be the most politically connected groups. Let's look at how the government of Zambia allocates its expenditures to agriculture. 56% of it, this blue one, is price supports through the marketing board. The red one is expenditures on the input programs. Where's the allocations to R&D that's appropriate for 1 hectare farms, extension service, tsetse fly control, veterinary services, all the things that are going to make that 1 hectare farm more productive? It's not here. As I've shown you before, you can see where the beneficiaries of the price supports are. So this may explain, therefore, why over the past 15 years, rural poverty is about where it started, somewhere close to 80%. So what's the message here? Let me just try to bring this back down to kind of boiling this down. I think the evidence is compelling that a broad-based, inclusive form of growth has the greatest prospects of reducing poverty, and that this is very consistent with evidence that's been produced elsewhere. I'll quote Michael Lipton here, who's a development economist in the UK, who in his analysis, concluded that except in the cases of a handful of city-states, there are virtually no examples of mass poverty reduction since 1700 that did not start with sharp rises in the productivity of small family farms. Okay, conclusions. I'll take about 10 minutes, and I think I should be done, Wally. On the conclusions, problems of inadequate access to land almost never feature in national development plans or poverty reduction strategies. To our knowledge, there has been inadequate recognition of the challenges associated with increasingly densely populated and land-constrained parts of rural Africa, despite the fact that a sizable and increasing share of its population live in such areas. Third one is that there's a growing perception that the development challenge for the region is just how to utilize the unutilized land resources in Africa, of which there are many. Especially since the rise of world food prices, there have been concerted efforts to transfer land out of customary areas, that's land that's under the jurisdiction of chiefs, customary lands, to the state or to private individuals who, it is argued, can more effectively exploit the productive potential of that land. Such efforts have nurtured the growth of a relatively well-capitalized class of emergent farmers. This is an interesting phenomenon going on where we did a survey in Zambia last year, 2011, where we tried to identify the characteristics of these emergent farmers. These are people with 10 hectares to 150, 200 hectares of land. We wanted to know about how they got to be there. Did they grow organically out of being small farmers? They were just successful and they expanded, or what? And it turned out that about 70% of those farms that we interviewed, turns out that they were civil service employees, or they were former politicians, or they were bankers, or even members of the military who had gained their income through off-farm, and then they were able to buy their way into land in the customary areas and have huge farms that are now producing the surpluses that I showed you in that bottom category. And many of those people being well-connected are the greatest drivers for the continuation of these input subsidy programs and price supports that continue to channel benefits mainly to the big farms. This is a story there are elements of this story that are similar to what's going on in the United States. So this is not a picture that's just unique to Africa by any means. The growing focus on how to best exploit unutilized land in Africa, I would argue, has diverted attention from the more central and enduring challenge of what to do about poverty and hunger in rural areas of Africa. So what to do now about this? I think it's interesting to look at the results of two meta-studies that were done fairly recently. The Economist Economic Intelligence Unit did a study of six countries in Asia, looking at what were the kind of public investments that gave the highest payoffs to both agricultural growth and poverty reduction. So I'm going to show you that in a minute. There was also an IFPRI study that was done by the DG of IFPRI, Shengen Fan et al. And they were looking more at South Asia. But they also tried to identify quantitatively what the biggest drivers were of ag growth. And I've ranked them for you. The Economist concluded that policies, really liberalization policies, were the biggest driver that unlocked agricultural growth in Asia. Road investments turn out to be very, very high. Agricultural R&D, again, consistently high. Down at the bottom of the list are some of the subsidy programs. And then this is in terms of agricultural growth. When you look at the rankings with respect to poverty reduction, it's quite similar. Road investments, ag R&D, policy, a good policy environment, all rank number 1, 2, and 3. So this has, if we believe these results, they have very important implications for what development strategy in Africa ought to look like. And then I contrast that here with how the allocation of public resources in Zambia, I'm picking on Zambia, but most of the countries that I have seen, this is a similar story. So R&D, I think that in terms of getting pragmatic now about where we need to go, redoubled public investment in the international and national agricultural research and extension systems, focusing on land-saving farm technologies and practices that are appropriate for 1 hectare farms. Number 2, physical infrastructure and land markets. I was living in Zimbabwe during the time when this Gokwe example came, and I think it's worth mentioning to you. Back in the late 70s, early 80s, this was the Ian Smith government moving into Robert Mugabe, and there was a policy, there was a recognition that many of Zimbabwe's rural areas were degraded, overexploited, densely populated. And there was this area called Gokwe, a huge area in kind of northwestern Zimbabwe, that was infested by tsetse fly and therefore sparsely populated. But the area was very fertile and it rained well. So the Zimbabwean government cleared that land of tsetse fly, built the roads, built the boreholes, built the schools, built the health facilities, and there was massive immigration out of the densely populated rural areas into Gokwe. And in a matter of 3 or 4 years, Gokwe became the center of Zimbabwe's smallholder maize revolution that occurred during the 1980s. Zimbabwe in the 1980s was actually a success story. And Gokwe was known as the white gold rush because of the cotton boom that occurred in that area. So there are examples of public investment strategies that have had a very high payoff to help facilitate migration from densely populated areas into less densely populated areas, of which there are many. So rather than just looking at the potential for foreign investment in unutilized land, is there some potential to have a public investment strategy that will help facilitate the transfer, the voluntary transfer of rural inhabitants into areas that are still productive and have the potential to turn them into examples like Gokwe. This is Wally's idea, public auction of land. If we're going to be moving to a system where there's going to be massive transfers of land, let's do it transparently. Let's have auctions. And let's use the raise the treasury revenue from this to facilitate greater investment in smallholder agriculture. And then the third part about what to do is to address land inequalities. Very strangely, there are very few land audits done in Africa. So there just isn't very much knowledge. This is a conclusion of Derek's report that I found very, very, very interesting. That there's no public data, accessible data, on how much customary land is still out there, how much has already been converted into private leasehold, how much state land is there that's unallocated, how much arable land is there in the customary land. There's virtually no information to guide public decision making on these issues. It might be deliberate, but that's the difficulty. And then the last issue that I'd like to put out for consideration is that for those who are using, who are owning land but not utilizing it, a land tax would be a perfect way of either getting them to use it more productively or selling it, so that it could be put in the hands of others who could use it more productively. In an area where land is scarce, and there are land scarce for many people, such a land tax could have great potential to open up a greater income and poverty reduction potential for smallholder agriculture. The problem with land taxes and why they haven't been implemented so far is that those who would need to vote them into existence are usually the ones who are owning a lot of that unutilized land. So there are major political economy problems in all of what we're talking about now. But dealing with those issues are going to be crucial. What are the consequences, my last slide, Wally? What's the consequences of doing nothing on this? Well, first consequence is that there's probably going to be major missed opportunities to reduce poverty in sub-Saharan Africa. It'll be closing off the most effective policy option, which is agricultural growth among a smallholder-led agricultural growth strategy. Unviable rural livelihoods contribute to urban migration, and then all of the attendant problems that we're seeing in the urban areas of these major cities. Slums, sanitation, health crises. In some areas, it's not a stretch to see how civil instability could be resulting from this, as it probably has in places like Rwanda and Burundi. And the inevitable rise here, if Paul Collier were here today, Paul Collier is, many of you are probably familiar with his work. He's a very well-known development economist in the UK. He is one of the gentlemen that is saying smallholder agriculture has no future, and that we need to go large farm route. He says this is inevitable, and he may be right. He may be right, not because large farms are really more efficient than small farms. In fact, the evidence is overwhelming that they're not, but because the public sector's expenditure patterns continue to be as such that favor the development of large farms rather than dealing with a small farm issue. So, ladies and gentlemen, with that conclusion, I would like to thank you for your time. Thanks.
Thank you very much, and good afternoon to everybody. It's my pleasure. I must confess that in more than 40 years in working in agricultural economics and development, this is my first visit to Stanford. So I guess it happens to everybody at some point. So thank you for the invitation. Let me say that congratulate Thom and his co-authors, I think, for a very comprehensive paper on a very important topic. And just seeing the number of people here, it indicates the interest. And two things that I really like about this paper. One, instead of starting off with land and land grubs and whatever the media has captured, he started with people. And where are the people? And I think what it gives is a different perspective on land issues in Africa when you start at where the people are and noting that many people are actually living in quite high population density areas. And then I think the other thing that Thom is able to do that a lot of other people, and particularly the media, are not able to do, he's able to back it up with a lot of very good micro-level farm household data. And I think that's what we really need, is much more evidence on the ground. So I have no major disagreements with Thom, and I, from my own personal experience, I've seen the land issue looming in Africa. When I started my PhD thesis on Nigeria, I dare say more than 40 years ago, there were 57 million people in Nigeria. Today there is 100 million people more, 160 million. The UN projection is that by 2050 there will be almost 400 million people. So it gives you sort of the indication of the very rapid change in the situation of population density in Africa. In colonial times, they used to worry about the underpopulation of Africa, and things have definitely moved on from that. I certainly have no disagreement with Thom's urging to focus on a smallholder productivity revolution in Africa as the way forward. Certainly, that was the message of the World Development Report that I worked on almost five years ago now, that was really critical. And it's not happening. And I think one statistic that is important to remember is that agricultural growth is actually up in Africa. If you look across regions, agricultural growth in Africa is actually higher than almost any other region. I'm not sure about East Asia. 5 to 6% in many countries. But where is that growth coming from? If you look at Keith Foodley's work from USDA, something like 70-75% of that is coming from land expansion. Very small share of it's coming from productivity growth. And that's something in terms of the sustainability, in terms of the numbers that Thom has given us, that has to change. That productivity revolution will take place in different ways in different countries, particularly depending on initial resource endowments. And I think one of the countries that I've worked on for over 30 years now and followed very closely is Ghana. Ghana is a success story in Africa in terms of poverty reduction and food security. And a big reason that Ghana has achieved success and it's success through agriculture, but it hasn't been through food crops so much, it's been through cocoa. And remember that there are different ways that you can achieve an agricultural transformation. In the few minutes that I've got, I will focus two comments. One is to elaborate on what Thom, and focus more on the low population density areas, the areas that I've been focusing on. And then also finish up perhaps disagreeing or perhaps admonishing Thom a little bit for one of the omissions, which is relating to land markets. In terms of low population density areas, and I think all the figures and even Thom's figures indicate that there are significant areas in Africa which have considerable agricultural potential but a relatively low population density. In the work that I did with Klaus Deininger and the World Bank, we indicated that this area is at least 200 million hectares and probably significantly more. Much of it focused on what's called the Guinea Savanna area, which is an area that's got medium to high agricultural potential, but only about 10% is cultivated. Now, within those areas, let's look at sort of the medium-low population density areas of, say, 25 to 75 persons per square kilometer. And these are areas where you've got a significant number of smallholders. And then the question is improving their productivity, and their productivity is going to be partly through adoption of new technologies, land-saving technologies such as seed and fertilizer. And all of the problems that Thom has indicated that are occurring, and Thom, in fact, we've co-authored a paper on all of the stop-start maize revolutions in Africa, and a big problem is the failure of governments to be able to transition to private sector input and output markets, and I think that's and corresponding failure to invest in things like rural roads. R&D and extension and so on. The thing I would add on to that, though, it's in these areas you've got land available. So the question is, how could you, some of these asset-poor households access some of that land, and why are they not accessing that land? And certainly you would need some labor-saving technology, and in countries like Thailand, I think, is a great model for Africa. Medium population, but where farmers have average farm size is often 2, 5, 10 hectares. And these areas, I think the low, the medium population areas do have potential to improve productivity through expansion of farm size using available land. Question is, why isn't that happening? My hypothesis is that it's access to land. The high transactions cost in accessing land at the local level because of a lack of land markets. And I'll come back and talk about that. But I think it's a hypothesis. And if there are graduate students in the audience, I hope that some of you will pick up this issue and really go out and do some really good micro level work, looking at the village level, the demographic change, land allocation, land access, and fallow management. There was a lot of good work done in the colonial times. There was some really good work done in the 70s. And there hasn't been anything done since then. So there's a big gap in our knowledge about why we're not getting the emergence in these medium, low population density areas of an entrepreneurial class of smallholder farmers that could be the breadbaskets for Africa and indeed for the world. Now let me turn to the very low, sparsely populated areas with agricultural potential. There we're talking about less than 25 persons per kilometer. And this has, I think, been the focus of what's called the global land rush, or you might say others call it the global land grab. And certainly there's a lot of activity there in terms of investment in these areas. It's not just foreign investments. In fact, it's a very heterogeneous group of investors that are coming in. And verified reports from Africa are something like 30 million hectares have been taken up in the last few years through those types of investment. Highly heterogeneous in terms of types of investors, foreign, local, pension funds, and the whole works, but also a very wide range of uses. Biofuels, by the way, is one that features fairly heavily in many of these types of investments. The question then is, could this work? And I tend to side with Thom. It's probably not your ideal way to go. These are areas that need a lot of investment. They need investment in infrastructure. They need investment in technology, soil amendments, disease control, and so on. I think the public sector is not, these days, is probably not going to do that. And so the question is, could this be co-financed by private investors? I think that you could think of some scenarios where this might work. I think of the Asian oil palm investors that are coming into Africa right now. They've got the technology. If they do this in a socially and environmentally responsible way, it can create a huge number of jobs. And I think one of the exceptions, Thom, to your smallholder farmer revolution is if you go to the outer islands of Sumatra or to Malaysia. It's been tree crops and big companies that have made a big difference in terms of poverty reduction. Of course, they've also knocked down a lot of forest in the process as well, but we can learn from those lessons. Also, outgrower schemes bring in the smallholders if you have a system where you can attract migrants to those areas. I think the other side of this is investors are coming in large-scale mechanized annual crop farming, things like maize and soybeans. I think that's if you've got a lot of experience in Africa, that this hasn't worked in the past, and I'm not seeing any real evidence that it's working now. And certainly the social impacts are not going to be very much because they don't create many jobs. And I think that's really what we should be focusing on in terms of poverty reduction, is job creation. Because if you look at the number of entrants into the labor force, it's roughly 25 million persons per year coming onto the labor force in Africa. And that's that's a real challenge. So to finish up with my last comment, and this is perhaps where I'd like to see the paper gone further, which is the whole question about land markets, formalizing land rights, and getting land markets to work. I think this is really an area where you know that 80% of in sub-Saharan Africa, 80% of land is under customary rights. It's an informal system in the sense that transactions are informal. The land rights are not recorded. And so when you have this population pressure, and on top of that you have commercial pressures coming in from investors, this system is just not going to stand up. It may have worked very well in the past in sub-Saharan Africa, but under the current pressures, it's simply not going to stand up. So if you had a better functioning land markets, it could reduce the transactions cost for investors. It allows some of these entrepreneurial smallholder farmers to access land, and it would provide an exit strategy for some of the people at the bottom end. And because land markets are not working well, capital and labor markets are not working well either. Labor markets in terms of the opportunity to attract immigrants. Now, this doesn't mean that you have to move to a full-scale private property rights. I think it can be done. It's countries like Mozambique are doing it, allowing customary rights to be recorded, allowing communities to transact and negotiate their own deals with investors, recording those rights, recording transactions, and getting full transparency into the system of land transaction. And I think this is one thing that we learn from the World Bank work on land grabs in Africa. There's just no transparency out there. And just getting transparency in these types of transactions, as in any type of real estate transactions, that would go a long way. I think some countries are moving in this direction, countries like Mozambique, Tanzania, even Ethiopia. Ethiopia is actually the only country in Africa that has registered most of their smallholders, and they're recorded. They're not allowed to buy and sell land, but there's a very active land rental market. So I think this is critical, and I think it's not only critical for the successful structural transformation, I think it's going to be really critical for maintaining peace and reducing conflict. I think a lot of the big conflicts that you've seen in Africa, if you trace them back, they relate to problems of land. If you look at Cote d'Ivoire, the recent civil war, it was about immigrants coming into the cocoa area, and eventually it boiled there. It worked for a while, but when the pressure came on and land ran out, that's when you got the conflict. Sudan, the conflicts that you're seeing in Sudan, a lot of this relates to this huge semi-mechanized agriculture that takes up about 10 million hectares of land in the Sudan, and has really trodden on the rights of customary users. So I will stop there. I think it's an important issue. I think we have, I agree with what Thom has said. I think there's still a big research agenda out there to look at some of these issues, and let's start seriously looking at land markets in Africa, land markets as they operate at the local level, and also land use and land use decisions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Thom and Derek, for a great set of comments. We have until 5:30 to have a discussion, and you've raised so many interesting issues. I'm just going to open it up immediately to questions. And I think there's a lot of great material that's been put in front of us here. So please. Yeah, Joanne.
Yeah, thanks for a terrific presentation.
And maybe introduce yourselves briefly as you speak.
I'm Joanne Gaskell. I'm a graduate student with the Center on Food Security and the Environment. And I'm thanks for great presentations. I'm curious to hear Thom's perspective now on why farmers are choosing to live in more densely populated rural areas as opposed to more sparsely populated areas. And is it that they don't have the choice? They can't purchase the land, or is it market access, or they want the schools, or?
So I'm going to repeat the questions just briefly. so everyone can hear. The question was really, why do people choose to stay in?
So I can hear.
Yes, so Derek. why are people in very densely populated areas choosing to stay there?
Yes, okay, good. Good question. The work that I've read on this, I haven't done anything myself on this, but the work that I've read on this, which is largely anthropological work and sociological work, is that in many parts of Africa, you are allowed to get land by customary right in your area, but you have no claims to land in outside your area. This is under a different headman, different chief, outside your clan. So there are cultural reasons why labor migration from densely populated to sparsely populated areas is not, not easy to do in many countries. In Ethiopia, it's really clear that you will not get land outside of your own area, not in a customary arrangement. The same thing for many parts of Kenya, even though there are land markets in Kenya. Kenya is a really interesting case on this. There are land markets in Kenya, but I have personal experience of people who have bought land with title deeds and got run out of that area because they were not part of the ethnic group. So there are ethnic issues that are inhibiting resettlement in many parts of the region. Not all of them, but many parts of them. Another part, there's historical issues here too that have to do with colonialism as well. Many countries like Zimbabwe, Zambia, Malawi, Kenya as well. There's a state land, and then there's customary land. And state land is under the authority of the government. And in these areas may be 500 hectare, 1,000 hectare farms, much of which is not being utilized. And yet, and right next door, there'll be a road there dividing it. On the other side of that road will be these densely populated rural areas. It's really a jarring picture to see this. And why couldn't these people migrate across the street? But it's these kind of regulatory problems that also get in the way. So there's two issues right there. There are others, but those are two pretty prominent ones.
Mm. Can I interject for just clarification to either of you? With the state or crown land, as opposed to customary land, is there any constitution around that? Is it at the will of the current government to be able to use it as they wish, or how does that work?
That's my understanding. Crown land or state land is under the authority of a land ministry, where the minister makes decisions on how land will be allocated within state land, and sometimes even within customary land.
So an outgoing minister might be able to sell that land and take the money and run.
Yeah, well, my understanding, and this is all, very, very opaque, but I would say that the conventional wisdom out there is that at the very highest levels of government is where decisions get made about allocating land to, for patronage reasons to, many people who will help keep the current government in power.
Yes, Rachel.
I'm Rachel. I'm another graduate student. Another graduate student in the Center for Food Security and Environment. I had a question about two groups. You mentioned 67% of the farmers in this one region weren't selling at all.
Yeah.
And I was just wondering if these were people that just didn't produce enough to sell beyond their subsistence needs.
Okay.
Or if there just wasn't, they weren't accessing markets.
Okay.
And then the other was about this group that you suggested taxing for not utilizing their land. Mm-hmm. And whether that was a question of the prices just not being high enough there for the foods. And I guess it's just in contrast to most of the other talks that we've had here, which have been about getting the prices right. Most of this is focused on this underutilized land, and
Okay.
So the target is on two groups, that lower group, the 67%, and the question is why aren't they entering the markets? And then the group that Thom suggests should be taxed, why aren't they using that land?
All right. Okay, good. Yeah, thanks for the question. It helps me to kind of clarify what a kind of a big picture point that I was trying to make and illustrate it with that particular slide. In almost all of the data sets that we've worked with, we see this phenomenon that the marketed surplus is very, very concentrated. So I was showing that like 2% of the households, it might be 3, it might be 1.5 in other countries, but a very, very small group produces half of the surplus in the country. And then you have this other kind of smallish group, 25-30%, who are still accessing markets. The reason why that bottom 67% can't access markets is not, well, why they don't sell anything is not because they can't access markets. Their neighbors are doing that who have bigger farm sizes. The reason why they can't sell that their any commodities is because they have inadequate assets to produce a surplus. So many of that 67% are actually buyers of food. They not only don't produce enough to sell, but they don't produce enough to feed themselves. So they're in the market as buyers back. So it's a very, again, it shows you how skewed the distributional effects are of setting $300 a ton prices. Not only does it greatly benefit the small proportion of households who sell a lot, but it disadvantages the majority who tend to be buyers. So it actually, has an adverse effect in more ways than one. Mm. Did I answer your question?
No, the those that are, you want to tax.
Okay, and the tax question, yeah. Okay, when you go out into the countryside, you can see a lot of land that's intensely cultivated on small farms, typically. And then you can see other farms that may be 50 hectares, 100 hectares, 1,000 hectares, a very small proportion of which is actually being used. So the land tax idea is in response to the fact that there's all this land locked up in private ownership but not being utilized. So why aren't they utilizing it? Well, there's a lot of, there might be speculation of the land going on. They may just not need to cultivate it because they're getting a lot of money from urban employment, many factors. But the idea is where you have a situation where you have land constraints among 80% and unutilized land among a small proportion of better off households. If you put a tax in place to make it more difficult for them to want to hold on to that land, and do nothing with it. This provides them with some incentive to get rid of it, sell it, and thereby make it available for the majority of households who could actually benefit from much greater access to land. So that's what a land tax would do. It would tax not everybody's land, but it would tax only unutilized land. It's been used, I think, elsewhere. Derek, do you want to have something to add on that?
Not to add. I just wanted to pick up a couple of points that I wasn't able to get out in my discussion comments and where I disagree with you.
Okay.
One is, I think missing from your paper, Thom, is the whole the effects of food prices. And I think when you look at the whole Green Revolution experience in Asia, a lot of the impacts on poverty reduction were through cheaper food for poor people, many of whom are farmers at the lower end of the spectrum. So I think what's the problem in the cases you've talked about is two problems. One is, of course, the larger farmers are getting the inputs rather than the smaller farmers. But the other is that the food prices are not being, the food markets are not being allowed to play out because of very significant intervention by food reserve agencies and so on in food markets. So in the long run, though, a significant part of your poverty reduction benefits are going to come from cheaper food. Mm-hmm. On taxes, I think this is an example where you have to have delineated and recorded land rights before you can start taxing. So you have to get that in place before you can have taxation. So it's a prerequisite. I think but I agree with you that a lot of the investors that have come in and we followed them up in the field, there's investment, the land's being allocated and approved, et cetera, but when you go out there, it's often not very much happening. So there's a certain amount of speculation out there. And what's happening is the global land prices have been going up. In sub-Saharan Africa, you could come in and get land for $5 a hectare still. So why not? Let's go for it and see what happens in the future and see if we can use that. So there needs to be obviously some conditions that not only the land is allocated, but it's utilized.
Yeah, and I think you made the point earlier that this is happening all over the world. You're seeing it in the United States, Indonesia, other places as well. So it's, yeah, very interesting. Eric.
Eric Lambin, from professor at Stanford. So two short questions on the land tax idea. Wouldn't you be concerned that it could have some dramatic consequence for the pastoralist population that use vast amount of land and it's just their traditional livelihood? And the second question, you, Thom, sometimes you gave the impression that the focus should be on small farms rather than on the large farms, you know, whether they are based on foreign investment or not. But couldn't we expect that investing on large farms will have some positive spillover consequence for the small farms through the development of infrastructure, markets, and technology that would benefit the smaller farms?
So the questions are on the land tax, how would that affect pastoralists? And also, aren't there some spillovers for large farms to small farms in terms of the marketing, supply chains, and infrastructure?
Okay. Land tax should be on unutilized land, not on utilized land. Pastoralists will be using that land. So yes, I agree that it shouldn't be, there needs to be a careful consideration of how to do it. But you know, my point is that in principle, when there's an area where you have big pockets of arable, fertile land locked up and not being used, that's the purpose that I'm talking about. The second point, which one was that again? Let me clarify at the risk of being misunderstood that I'm not anti-large farm at all. There is a place for large farms. Derek mentioned that, you know, one of the major benefits of having large-scale commercial farms is the surpluses that get produced can help lower food prices and have all sorts of general equilibrium benefits for the whole population. So the difficulty I have is where there is land that could be allocated in the future for smallholder-based development through, you know, a comprehensive public investments program of road investment. This gets to the question that you raised first about why is it that there's not this kind of migration from densely populated to sparsely populated areas. There's many areas in the continent that are still very capable of supporting a hospitable smallholder-led development program, but the public investments need to be put in place to facilitate that and then, you know, get people to migrate into those areas as they did in the given the Gokwe example in Zimbabwe that I tried to highlight. I think that is a very instructive model for many countries in the region to start thinking about how to deal with this problem of currently under or unutilized land coexisting with you know, massive land pressures in smallholder areas. But I'm not recommending it in any way like a bias against large-scale farms. It's really an empirical question about, you know, cost-benefit analysis. What kind of land settlement pattern would provide the greatest benefits to the country in terms of food security, poverty reduction, growth, and so forth? It just so happens that most of the evidence on this does, I think, support a smallholder-led path.
I think the spillovers, what I've seen is in certain crops, in the sort of the cash crops like sugarcane, oil palm, even some of the horticulture, you do see significant spillovers. And some of that is deliberate government policies to facilitate outgrower schemes. So if you go to Ghana, you look at the oil palm plantations, they all have a significant number of smallholders associated with those oil palm, which are and the technology is more or less the same. So there are, and of course, the infrastructure in terms of the processing bill and so on, that's all important to get smallholders moving. What I have problems with is some of these large-scale mechanized food crop farms where the technology is going to be so different. There's a famous case right now of an Iowa maize farmer going into western Tanzania that's going to grow 100,000 hectares of maize and soybeans. Well, first of all, I think he's going to go belly up because I don't think he's got the technology. But even if he is successful, I don't think the spillovers are going to be very, there may be a bit of infrastructural spillover. But the technology is not going to spill over because it's such a vastly different level of technology to what you would use in a smallholder farm situation. And I think what the work that we did in the report, that Africa's sleeping giant, on the looking at Thailand versus the Cerrado of Brazil, and Thailand went much more of an emerging smallholder model, whereas Brazil went much more for a larger. I think the poverty reduction impact are clearly much higher in the Thai case.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Ewell Igal, and I'm a director of a nonprofit organization working in Africa. I have a question for you. The top of your recommendation is policy, so can you go a little bit deep in the policy? What is your recommendation?
Okay, on the policy side. Okay.
And micro level, if you could just pinpoint.
Okay.
So the question is on the recommendations, the top recommendation, can you go into more detail on this?
Okay. All right. The fact that policy came out to be number one in the study that The Economist did, this was in Asia, much of the story that they tell is that there was so much potential locked up under the socialist, communist, Vietnam, the other Myanmar, so forth, that just freeing, unshackling private enterprise and private entrepreneurship to, you know, from those kind of strictures had a very important impact on private, you know, smallholder investment in agriculture. In a country like Ethiopia, I don't know. I'm not sure exactly, because I think it's going to probably vary from country to country. But the studies that I've seen recently on Ethiopia point to some difficulties in the input distribution system, over-regulation of them, and so forth. So I think it's got to vary from one country to the other. But in general, I'll admit it, I'm a supporter of liberalization. I think that most of the impacts of liberalization have been very positive for the country. Even though I know that's a controversial statement. Yeah.
Derek, since you also wrote the World Development Report, which had a large segment on policy, do you want to add to?
Well, I think the general perspective, and maybe again I'm contradicting Thom, is that policy is much better in Africa today. And I think, Thom, you're looking at your two countries, Zambia and Malawi. And of course, Ethiopia is another example. But the majority of African countries have moved to a much more liberal policy regime. I think there's two levels to this. One, the macroeconomic policy is much better.
Yes.
I think you would agree with that.
Agree.
Exchange rates are now at reasonable levels, and inflation is down, and fairly open trade, and so on. I think at the sector level is where the biggest problem is in many cases. And I think what we've seen also over the last two or three years is a move back to more state intervention in agriculture. I've seen this in Ghana. Ghana was a country that really did open up. I mean, you couldn't have seen a country more screwed up in terms of economic policy than Ghana in around 1980. And then it really did open up. It had a big impact. As you can see, Ghana has been a success story. But then they've opened up fertilizer subsidies, input subsidies, tractor hire schemes run by governments and so on. And I see that as a step backwards. I think Ghana was really making good progress, and I don't see why they needed to do that.
Yeah. Well, I think we're actually agreed on that point. That I would point to the continued re-intervention. That there was a liberalization process. I agree with you, Derek, that on the macro side things are much better than they were. It used to be that the exchange rates of all of these government countries were controlled. There were black markets on currency all over. You don't see much of that anymore, thankfully. But on the sectoral side, very quietly, these programs have reemerged where they're channeling, just like I showed, they're channeling income through price supports to a very, very narrow segment of the farm population, and probably not the most needy ones. So you can see, you can see that the allocation of public funds has been skewed away from meeting the needs of the bottom 70% and much more towards meeting the needs of the top 2%. And in a political economy framework, you can see exactly why that's happening. Many of the people who own that land are in parliament or in some other government body, so it becomes extremely difficult to unlock from that. So I would still say that sectoral policy is a big problem. Yeah.
So as long as we're on the topic of that list, I've always been perplexed on that list why irrigation falls at the bottom of that list, because when we think about trying to intensify the existing land as opposed to getting all the productivity out of expanding land, certainly Asia's experience was irrigation in combination with the new cultivars led to the very high yields and productivity growth. In Africa, it's more difficult because it's much more heterogeneous. And one question is, rather than large-scale irrigation, would small investments in small-scale irrigation that clearly show much higher returns, isn't that worth pursuing? Why do you two think that's on the bottom of the list? Should it be? When we're thinking about land, don't we also need to move from only 4% irrigated to more irrigation in Africa?
Yeah. You want to take that?
No, I think it's a good question. I would certainly say small-scale irrigation is a high priority. And I think if you look at investment patterns and you look at World Bank support, there's a significant amount of that. There's some really good success stories in northern Nigeria and Niger of small pumps, even treadle pumps, that are making a difference, particularly in terms of a second winter crop for high-value horticulture. I think the large-scale irrigation schemes are the big questions, and there's been a lot of failures in that in Africa, and it's a very high-cost venture. And the figure I just saw for Senegal for a large-scale irrigation project, $15,000 per hectare to grow rice. Now, if rice prices stay where they are, okay, it may work, and if the irrigation system is managed better, but there has been some real progress in large-scale management of large-scale irrigation. Senegal River Valley, the off-east in Niger and Mali, you look at rice yields now in those areas, are up around 5 tons per hectare, Asian standards, and it's largely through better management of large-scale irrigation. So large-scale irrigation is back on the agenda as well. The question is how to finance it, and is it going to pay especially for grain production? Should it be for just high value production? Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I really have nothing to add to that.
Yeah, I think I'm on the same page with Derek. Way in the back.
My name is Sandy Chang. I've done some work with the World Bank in Tanzania and in Kenya, and you don't need to emphasize how important land tenure is a huge issue, especially when it comes to conservation on land. I was wondering if you had some ideas regarding how to reconcile the customary land rights, state, and all these different, since it's so central to the issue, have you had some thoughts on how to reconcile these different type of land rights?
$64,000 question, isn't it?
How to reconcile different types of land rights.
Yeah. I don't think there's any clear answers in preparation for this seminar, I've read quite a bit of literature on this. And
you know, from a positive standpoint, there's a lot of analysis about what is happening out there, what's actually happening. But there's much less out there on the normative side that's trying to assess what should be done in order to deal with this problem. I've tried to highlight a few issues there at the end, which I think have some promise. Derek has highlighted land markets, the commodification of land as one way of doing that. The concerns that I'm aware, that you hear raised about land markets is that it will probably tend to concentrate the holdings of land even further, because the ones with the resources and the money are going to outbid those with no money, and it'll actually lead to the, many of the poor, rural poor leaving the farm with $200 in their pockets in order to make good whatever they can do in urban areas. And I'm not sure that's a prudent poverty reduction strategy, but I'm not sure that this. I agree with Derek that the status quo is not going to work either, because as land becomes more scarce, we're seeing chiefs allocate land to big interests. We're seeing smallholder farmers sort of get the short end of the stick that way too. As pressure, and we've interviewed chiefs in Zambia, and they said you wouldn't believe the pressure that we're under from the state to basically cede land out of our control. They're willing to give us, the chief things to do that, but they're under intense pressure right now as land becomes more and more scarce. So neither the current system looks like it's very viable. But I'm not sure what the distributional effects of just trying to get land markets going would be either. So short of the things that I've mentioned, I really don't have any good answers for that.
Maybe I'll just add a couple of examples. One, coming out of a socialist system, Ethiopia, I think, is a good example, where the farmers have farmers and their wife or husband, and this is a good case where a woman have been fully considered in the land titling system, but all farmers, practically all farmers in Ethiopia now have a certificate of their rights to that land for it to be inherited. They can rent it. The only thing they can't do is sell it. But it was done for about $1 per hectare, so $1 per pot. I can't remember the, so it's very cheap. And I think quite effective, and if you go back and you talk to Ethiopian farmers, they're very happy, they feel much more secure, and you also see evidence of a very rapidly emerging land rental market in Ethiopia. I think the big step to Ethiopia now is going to be to open up to land sales. From the former socialist countries that have done that, Vietnam's the one that's done it in Vietnam. I think it didn't have the distributional impacts that people expected. In fact, it allowed some of the poorer farmers to access additional land. Now, Vietnam has got a very dynamic non-farm sector, so that was an opportunity for that, to allow people to exit agriculture, that they get rid of their land. Mozambique has worked much more on the customary land rights. Their law, as I think everybody says, and land, I'm not a land expert, a land tenure expert anyhow, that Mozambique is a model law. You can go out, you can delineate, you can register your land, you can negotiate deals with investors and so on. The question is how to implement that. And there's only, I think, about 7%, if I recall, 7 or 10% of Mozambican communities have yet recorded their land holdings. And also in Mozambique, if a community decides, they can divide it up into individual parcels for virtually freehold land tenure, if they decide. So I think it's going to be very interesting to watch. I think conceptually there's some really good cases out there of model land laws. Zambia is not one, but Mozambique, I think Tanzania, Uganda, But the actual implementation in practice, and of course it's still relatively costly to go out and do that cadastral survey and to register your rights. So you've got a lot of civil society organizations going out there actually helping to do this. So it's happening slowly. Mm-hmm.
So based on your experience with the land institutions, if American farmer, like an Iowa farmer, bought the land in Tanzania, or a Chinese group bought land in Zambia, for example, are they secure in that land, or could that just be taken away? I mean, it seems so risky, too, because if there's no land markets, even mm-hmm. though it seems like a land grab and a land steal, it doesn't, to me, they can't take their land away. That could be taken away from them. So. Mm-hmm. Curious about your perspective on it.
Yeah, well, that's a really interesting question, and it's one that I'd have to be subjective about in the way I answer it, because we really don't have a lot of evidence to draw on. But if I were an investor in Ethiopia, I'd be worried about whether that land could 10 years down the line be taken away under some pretext. There's enough historical examples of people losing rights to private land in some countries, some much more than others, that I think it's got to be a consideration. Probably varies greatly, but across countries.
Mm. Yeah, I think there are examples of plantations in Ghana, Kenya, and so on, large-scale landholdings that have been there since colonial times. And they're still there, so I guess there's some security. Most of these contracts are 30 years, some of them up to 50 years. And the only example I know of, and one that's been taken away, is the Procanya case in Mozambique. It was a sugarcane ethanol outfit, I think a South African investor. And the reason it was taken away is because they didn't invest what they said they were going to invest. That was part of the deal. So the government, and then there was a lot of civil society pressure on that, and because there were previous land rights that weren't being respected, so it's actually the project was cancelled by the Mozambican government.
Thanks. Yeah, Barry.
My name is Barry Riley, and I'm a visiting scholar here. In the late 80s and early 90s, I was with the World Bank, and I worked a lot in Ethiopia, and I've continued to track the food security issues in Ethiopia for a long time. And I'd like to ask both of you whether you think that the government's attempt to decentralize authority to the regions and then to the wardas, including passing budgets down, has improved their ability first in the land issues, ensuring that the traditional land procedures in Tigray, which were much more communal, if they've taken that kind of local traditional methodology into account, and whether if they have, if it's helpful. And secondly, I haven't heard anything at all about the issue of working through communities of farmers rather than individual farmers, which is very much the methodology in Ethiopia, the farmers associations. Is that helpful?
Well, on the Ethiopian one, yes, maybe Ethiopia is decentralized on paper, but in practice it's a very highly centralized system, and the Prime Minister's word is really what counts in Ethiopia. So I'm not sure there's been as much experimentation. I think what you're arguing for is has there been a lot of experimentation as there has been in Indonesia under decentralization, where different communities and districts do things different ways. I was in Ethiopia with the World Bank before I left the World Bank, and I didn't see a lot of differences. Maybe some of the Tigray may be probably the one that's advanced most in terms of implementing its own way of doing things, but I think Tigray has got its own central special place in terms of the Ethiopian hierarchy. On Farmers Association, I think, do you want to take that?
No, go ahead.
No, I think there's in terms of, particularly in terms of being able to organize in terms of markets, input markets and so on, I think there's a really important role there. I see that the Francophone countries in West Africa, I think, is where the farmers associations are most developed. They're taking over cotton production in the Sahel in some countries. And then one of the nice ones I've seen recently is in Cote d'Ivoire, despite its civil war and so on. There's a very strong farmers, what they call professional associations. And they raise money from a levy on all output, and they spend it on extension, research, all the things that Thom was arguing for. And I think it's been quite successful for cash crops. So there is a role there.
I'm Mike Abkin. I'm with the National Peace Academy, and food security is an important part of human security, important part of peace building. So I'm interested in that. But I'm going to talk to Mike. I have a two-part question on the environment. End of food security of environment. Talk about undeveloped, underdeveloped land, and I'm asking, is that relative to human unutilized and underutilized, that human not utilizing, but what other ecological uses might there be going on, quote unquote, uses of that land that might be lost if you had more of that used to agriculture, and what would be the costs in the overall ecosystem, including human activities, of losing that land to, or converting that land, let's say, to agricultural uses. Yeah. And the second related part has to do with the list of strategies you had up there about policies and research and mm-hmm. investment and so on. What of those policies, or how could those policies, those strategies, be configured, or how might the choice among them, the rankings of them, be determined so that they could be the most robust and most resilient given the global climate change, mm-hmm. which is underway already. It's a certainty, even though the evolution of it is uncertain how it's going to go. But we want to develop strategies that will be robust under however it goes as best we can, because mm-hmm. 20, 30 years is not that far. Mm-hmm. You think 40 years ago, we might be having we're having similar conversations 40 years ago, and we're still having them. So 40 years from now, it's going to be a very different world. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of the two things I'd like to look at.
Okay. All right. Well, I'm glad you raised that first issue in particular, because I think that there's convergence on the view that if it's possible to feed the world and to feed the countries, through making existing farmland more productive without having to touch further expansion into grassland and forest land, that's the win-win outcome if it can be achieved, because of the very reasons that you've alluded to, that there's an environmental cost to mowing down the forests and converting current land that's unexploited. In fact, I just read an article by Jonathan Foley just the other day that said that his view is that we can't afford to expand additional land in many parts of the world because the environmental cost will be so high. So he's really putting the whole burden on yield growth of existing farmland. And of course, if that can be achieved, great. But whether it can or not, it will now make these trade-offs much more stark, won't they? That when it comes to sustaining forest land for carbon and other reasons, what's going to be the cost in terms of food insecurity to some groups? So it's just going to make these trade-offs very stark. I certainly don't have an answer to that, but just that. And I think Derek's report also makes this very clear as well. To the extent that it's possible to just not have to expand land, but to get higher yields on existing land, that's the way that our research systems ought to be, you know, aligned if we can put enough resources into them to achieve that. On the climate change issue, I wish we could turn the microphone to David Lobel, who's working on the same issues that you've just talked about, and I think that he'd be in a better position to talk about that than I would, for sure. I really don't have good insights to your second question. Derek, I don't know whether you have.
No, on the climate change, not in front of David, and then on the first question, not in front of Thom Hertel, who's sitting back there. but the intensification, yes. We've done with some of Thom Hertel's colleagues just a recent paper looking at the impact of the Green Revolution on land savings. We estimate around 15 million hectares. I got that right. Doesn't sound like a lot, but it's certainly very significant. But of course, intensification doesn't always work. And then one of the big arguments in Southeast Asia is when you have oil palm comes in, highly profitable crop, it's a real incentive to knock down the forest as well. The intensification can work on the one side, but you need better forest governance on the other side to save your forest.
I might just add one on the population issue too, since population growth is part of the problem here that we're talking about, that investments that may be outside of agriculture, like education and healthcare for women, that would bring fertility rates might be one that we might add to the list. Wally?
From the center here. I can get encouraged about what I see about global or regional continental agricultural production from Africa. But what I find distressing, and I don't altogether get much hope from your presentations today, is on the poverty side. I'm distinguishing production from poverty. And given the problems of land systems and land markets, given the problems of migration into these other areas, a whole lot is riding on what you can do with 1 hectare farms, even if you invest. And I would be interested if either of you could talk to the sort of the base technology issues that you see out there, where a new investment program or a new set of policies might really change output on these very small farms. And I don't see it. I'm hoping that you do.
Okay. That's a great question, Wally. When we have done many of these household or farm surveys on response to fertilizer, this is just an example, there is extreme variability even in the same villages, in the same agroecology and so forth. So highly variable responses to input use and so forth. It really, in my view, brings us back to that it can't be achieved closing this yield gap, and the technologies that are appropriate to 1 hectare farm. It's not just a matter of getting the technology out there. There's a management issue here. And the agronomists and the crop scientists and so forth, they have a checklist of 20 things in order to, you know, one of them is soil testing to understand what's the right nutrient mix that needs to be put on. Many of the fertilizers that are used in Africa, it's just bring in NPK, bring in NPK, bring in NPK. Well, it may be that there are other limiting, you know, nutrients that aren't in NPK. So soil testing, number one. Drainage, number two. So investments in land to reduce water logging, which reduces yields greatly in many contexts, of flooding and so forth. Number three, getting the right plant population, row spacing, seed spacing. These are all management issues. Number four, investing in seed research systems that can produce improved varieties. There's a great potential for expanded yield growth on 1 hectare farms from that. Number five, the jury is out on conservation agriculture, but there are many advocates that say we need to move towards conservation agriculture, conserving water, especially in variable climate conditions. There's about 20 things, many of which is management, herbicides, the whole gamut. But unfortunately, what I see too much in the prioritization of public investments as just monofocus on fertilizer. Fertilizer. Fertilizer's got to be part of the solution, but in order for farmers to utilize that and get high response rates out of it, there's 5 or 6, 10, 20 other things that need to go along with it that just aren't on the radar screen right now. And I've tried to make the point here that, you know, in the pie chart of public investments, only a very tiny sliver of that is being allocated to those kind of things, improving management issues and getting the right agronomic practices being carried out on 1 hectare farms. So, yeah.
Can I add to that? I think on technologies, I've been working on a large project on looking at adoption of improved varieties in Africa. In the last time we had any sort of a continent-wide estimates, is something like 20%, 20-25% of the area in sub-Saharan Africa was under improved varieties. That's relative to probably 90% in Asia at that time. The update looks like we're going to be about double this in 2010, so we may be around 40%. And don't quote me on this. The numbers are just coming in, but certainly in certain crops, the maize, cassava, and being two of the major ones, we're seeing very significant adoption over the last 10 years. You don't see much impact on yields. So what's happening? Yes, fertilizer. And I think, you know, if you're using 10 kgs of fertilizer in sub-Saharan Africa relative to rain-fed areas in the rest of the world, around 100 kgs, there's obviously a huge gap there. And I would agree with Thom, if you current fertilizer prices in Africa, which are roughly double what they are in other regions, you need very good management to make a profit. So the question then is working on your fertilizer markets, input distribution, dealers, transport, logistics, et cetera, and then the risk side of it, I think, is the other major. So there's the question there. And let's not just think about food grains. There's high-value agriculture. I think these small farmers in Kenya, it's going to be horticulture, dairy. It's not going to be maize. It's going to get them out of poverty. And then I think we've dropped the ball on tree crops. I think tree crops, look at the small tea, coffee, oil palm, rubber. Rubber is a real success in some parts of West Africa now. I think that can really, one hectare of rubber can keep you going and probably get you out of poverty.
So we're reaching really the end here. I'm going to ask us a quick parting question that's sort of a yes-no question. And if the answer is yes, then we'll have to talk about the implications for poverty and the environment over drinks. Okay. So the question is, in 30 years from now, will that Guinea Plateau,
yes,
which is an expansive land, be all agriculture? And, what's that going to look like? Will it be like the Brazilian Cerrado in 25 or 30 years?
Mm-hmm. Go for it. You wrote the book on that. You should.
Do we want it to look like the Brazilian Cerrado? That's the big question. I would much, my vision for that area would be small, emerging smallholder medium farmers coming out of the existing populations, supported by public infrastructure, perhaps with private investment coming in on the seed systems and so on. That would be maybe 5, 10, 20 hectares of land, maybe even more in 30 years' time. I think that would be more the Thailand example of how you, where you've got the land, you could make a difference both in terms of food security and poverty reduction.
Okay. I guess the vision that I see for many parts of Africa where I work is that there needs to be a public investment strategy that will expand access to land in areas that are currently underutilized to allow some kind of natural migration to be going into these areas, relieve the population pressures, allow some kind of broad-based rural-led development strategy in the short and medium run. in the longer run, as that, you know, just like in Asia, as that growth process occurred, there will be many of the more marginal farmers who will now have a livelihood off the farm. So this idea of getting migration off the farm into productive urban jobs. It won't happen if it's done prematurely. It'll only happen when there's enough money being recycled out of rural areas to fuel the demand for off-farm jobs. So that's why there's really no substitute for a broad-based agricultural growth strategy in agrarian societies where you've got 70% of the population still in agriculture. So I think that's got to be the program. It needs a public investments strategy that's coherent and that's compatible with a smallholder-led approach. If it's not, it won't be achieved. And then we'll be into plan B, which would not be nearly as good. So
please join me in thanking both Thom and Derek for a great talk.